Speaking of that, some viewers will watch this and react to me sitting here chatting with what they call a war criminal. Being a human being, is that it must be hurtful to be called a war criminal. I mean, some...
Look, you will get protests against American and British soldiers being in Iraq or Afghanistan. You won't get any protests about the people driving car bombs into the middle of Kabul, Baghdad, or Karachi, or anywhere else, and killing innocent people. Now, to me, that means the world's got its priorities upside down. You know, you can agree or disagree with what we did in Iraq or indeed in Afghanistan, but the truth is, we removed brutal dictatorships, gave the people a chance to vote in an election, which they took, and gave them unlimited money to rebuild their country.
But you never removed any weapons of mass destruction. That's the problem, is it?
I think the problem's twofold, actually. I think there's the issue to do with the weapons, and what I say to people on that is go and read the Iraq Survey Group report, which was compiled after the war, after the removal of Saddam, and, you know, which intelligence remains, which is now wrong, what Saddam's actual intentions were, what is... people were going to do, is there explained.
Did you ever discuss just, this might be naive, but did you ever discuss just going in and get him? I mean, not going to war, but going in and just get Saddam? Or have I seen too many James Bond films?
I think so, yeah. I mean, one of the things that I often say to people is, you know, you could have left him there. I mean, I was just about to say about this Iraq Survey Group report, because no one reads it now. But this is the full report, with the interviews with Saddam, with his top people and all the rest of it. And essentially what they did was they decided, when sanctions were crumbling, to get rid of the physical evidence, but to retain the scientists and the laboratories and the know-how. And they, as the report finds, confirmed by the Butler report in the UK, they retained the intention to restart a chemical and probably a nuclear weapons program. Now, I don't believe Saddam had ever given up that intention, which is why I think you would have had to have dealt with them at some point anyway.
But is it... I don't have the ambition to make you today say that Iraq was wrong. I don't think you will, because you actually don't seem to doubt at all.
It's not that I don't doubt, it's that I see the other point of view.
I know, but could you describe the doubt?
Yeah, the doubt is, it's an incredibly difficult judgment.
Because you ask other people to see another point of view, and then I
wonder...
Yeah,
and so I do. You know, I totally understand.
And you still do.
I still see completely the other point of view. This is the most difficult judgment I ever made in politics. And I totally understand why someone says, look, it would have been better just to have left him there. Okay, you might have, you know... Okay. Now, what I say to people who take that point of view is, but don't then give me this line that somehow there was another way of dealing with them, because there wasn't. You would have left him there, and there would have been consequences of that.
I think it's interesting that you, being the great communicator, not... managing to communicate this to people. I mean, because...
Well, it's pretty difficult, isn't it? I mean, it's bound to be difficult.
Yes, but, I mean, if anyone could do it, it should be you.
Yeah, but, I mean, that's, you know, it's not a question of communication.
Is it frustrating for you?
No, it's not frustrating for me at all. Because I also think there will be a longer perspective about this. So I was going to say to you...
So you will be right in, like, 50 years?
I'm not sure about that, but I do think people will come in time to see this as having two aspects to it. One is the WMD aspect. But let's be clear about this. If we'd removed Saddam in 2003, and had been, which we did, May 2003, took us 2 months, and then there'd been peace in Iraq, you wouldn't be having this conversation with me.
Well, we don't know, do we?
Well, it's unlikely. The fact is, what then happened after the removal of Saddam was 6-7 years of bloodshed. And that's what people find impossible to... Because then they say, look, you've made the situation worse. You went in there, you stirred up the hornet's nest, and now look at the situation.
How irritating was it to be called Bush's poodle? I mean,
not very irritating, because it's just a term of abuse, isn't it? I mean, those aren't the difficult arguments to deal with, actually. I mean, you were asking me a bit ago.
Not the, like the be liar science and...
But that's just abuse. That's not a...
But for the family,
No, well, of course. But then you're in politics, you know. If you're in politics, that's the way things are. So you just get used to that. But those aren't the arguments that you've got to deal with. The arguments you've got to deal with is the more intelligent argument that says, look, in the end, yes, Saddam was a monster, he was a terrible person, but the cost of removing him was too great. Yeah, that's an argument I understand. Now, I've got my answers to that, but that's an argument I respect, I understand.
You're a religious man. What has faith to say here for you?
Look,
taking a decision like this.
It doesn't answer those questions, you know. It really doesn't, I'm afraid. Because in the end...
Were you a praying man at that time?
Well, if you are someone of faith, prayer's a part of your life. It's not something you do at particular moments. But faith doesn't tell you the answer to these questions, I'm afraid. Sometimes people say to me about the book, they say, look, you're a very religious man, but you don't talk much about religion. I say, because religion doesn't tell you the answer to political questions, I'm afraid. Your faith can give you strength in terms of how you approach decisions. It can give you a certain, you know, serenity in the face of challenge. It doesn't tell you what the level of the minimum wage should be, and it doesn't tell you whether it's right to remove Saddam or right to keep him.
There was a huge general pressure on you at this time. Mm-hmm. How did you cope with this? I mean, I read somewhere that Cherie said you were often quite tired.
Yeah, I think that would be... It would be pretty odd if you were prime minister, even in normal times, and you weren't tired from time to time. It's a job you're expected to work hard at.
And you write in your book about how coming home and having perhaps a drink or two too much.
You know, one of the things, again, which I've tried to do in the book is to write honestly about these types of things. And, you know, I have to say my hard-drinking friends think the idea of a gin and tonic and a couple of glasses of wine is indicating you're a heavy drinker is one of the more pathetic admissions of the dangers of alcohol. But, no, I think as you get older, you've got to be careful of alcohol because it becomes a prop. I'm not saying after we do all the interviews today and your interview, I won't go and have a drink, but you're just going to know about it.
One final person we have to discuss a little is Gordon Brown, your mm-hmm. chancellor and also successor. Because you were so close for so many years, and still you describing in the book, and this is a juicy part for many people in Britain, I know, as maddening and also lacking emotional intelligence. And I wonder, do you still like him?
I do like him, actually. I respect him and I like him. But we had a disagreement. And, you know, some people think that I really shouldn't have described this disagreement.
And he really wanted your position.
Yeah, but I never minded that, you see. This is the point. I was always very happy for him to want my position.
As long as you had it?
Well, yeah, and even to remove me, provided he had a better idea of how to govern the country. And what I didn't want was him to take over the Labour Party and then lose the election.
But who was defining who had the best idea?
Well, that's the point. That's the debate you will always have. So, basically, I've always said about Gordon... There are two sides. There's the very difficult side and the very brilliant side.
But what's the difficult side?
The difficult side was he could be extremely difficult to work with. And in the end, I'm afraid, we had this problem, which was a basic fundamental disagreement about the direction of the Labour Party.
You could get rid of Saddam Hussein. How come you couldn't get rid of him?
Well, I wouldn't put Gordon in that category. So, I mean, you know, the fact is he was a brilliant guy and achieved an enormous amount for the country. So I didn't want to get rid of him in that sense at all. I mean, I could have obviously removed him or replaced him as Chancellor. I decided not to because he did a brilliant job. In many ways, one of the reasons why we did end up being such a long-serving Labour government was because of his chancellorship.
Has he read the book?
I honestly don't know.
You're actually, even today, you're a controversial figure, a controversial politician, ex-politician. Mm-hmm. And signing your book now, you had to cancel one signing because of the same. People throwing eggs.
I know, but these people are reasonably. You know, the thing about it is what I call in today's politics the tyranny of the protest. Right? If you get 1,000 people in a room and 5 people get up and shout at you, they will get the news that night, and the 995 who just want to be there and listen to you won't get a look in. It's the way it is. So. You know, in Ireland, what we actually had was a mixture of anti-war people, but also anti-peace people, dissident Republicans protesting about peace in Northern Ireland, which is the peacemaking part of my premiership. You know, they turn up, they throw things, they shout, but But you've got hundreds of people lining up to get their book signed. But the people who get the publicity are the people who throw the eggs. Well, it's just the way it is.
Would you say that Iraq has hardened you?
No. It's the job has to give you a certain hardness, because otherwise you can't take the decisions.
But is that what you mean when you write that you started out as one type of leader and then you ended as another?
I think it's really to go back to where we started, which is this: once you realize that this huge optimistic expectation is in some sense a bit of an illusion on both parts, the people and the leader, then you have to settle down to realize that you will, as you take decisions, disappoint people. You will alienate people. People will get angry. You know, the government that I led was in power twice as long as the longest-serving Labour government before then. And therefore, I also had a huge and ferocious onslaught from the right, because we introduced a minimum wage, we made big investments in public services, we had equality for gay people, you know, we had massive changes in maternity and paternity rights, our tripled aid to Africa, we led on climate change, you know, we had a whole agenda that the right hated.
This was before Iraq.
After Iraq. I mean, I didn't stop.
Yes, but I wonder, is that why you're writing the book now, why you're touring now, is to sort of try to set the record straight?
No, I wrote the book because I wanted to...
Try to write your epitaph. I don't know.
You don't do that. It's partly I wrote the book, actually, because I still think that there's a relevance about the issues I'm talking about then. And talking about now, but when you are a progressive politician, certainly in my politics or in the US politics, I mean, you look at what Obama's getting now. I mean, you know, he's treated as if he's some sort of alien in parts of the American media. So you just got to get used to that. But part of it derives from the fact that you've been successful.
Tony Blair, thank you so much for spending the time here tonight.
It's my pleasure. It's great to be back in this absolutely wonderful, beautiful city.
And are you saying hello to Göran Persson?
I certainly am. Yeah, Göran was a great guy when I was... he was a fantastic colleague when I was... he was always really good value and a very wise man, actually. Always worth listening to.
Have you been visiting him at this...
I was hoping to see him, actually, but unfortunately I think he's injured his leg or something, he told me, I don't know, something like that. But the last time I spoke to him, he was... In the summer, he was sitting out having a beer.
Thank you so much,
okay.
Tony.
Thank you.
Could we just have a picture? Yes, just a press photo, is that okay?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like world leaders, and I feel like a world leader now.
Thank you so much. Not with the time. Okay.
Thank you so much, and good luck with the other arrangements here.
See you next
okay.
time.
Bye.
On the telephone.